high-powered world of professional sport, it is the winners that draw the crowds and cover the front page. It is easy to forget yesterday's heroes, out with injuries, whose memories are sometimes left on a shelf, along with their accomplishments. Knocked to the canvas time and time again, this is the dramatic story of a superstar's iron will and determination. It is the story of Philadelphia Flyer Tim Kerr, fighting back. In April of 1987, Tim Kerr left the ice in agony with a severely dislocated shoulder. For the Flyers' top scorer, it was a prolonged, painful injury that finally stopped number 12 midway through the Flyers' march to the Cup Finals that spring. Unbeknownst to Tim, his visits to the hospital had just begun. Flyers' orthopedic surgeon John Gregg described Tim's early condition.
One time his shoulder dislocated out the back, and then another time it came out the front, and after that his shoulder became very, very unstable. So much so that if his arm was at his side and he'd just turn his arm out, you could watch his shoulder come out of joint.
The only Flyer ever to score 50 or more goals in four consecutive seasons, Kerr missed the Stanley Cup Finals with an injury for the second time in 3 years. This would turn out to be the most traumatic injury of his career.
So we arthroscoped his shoulder to see what all the problems in it were. Did he have a torn rotator cuff? It turned out that one, he had arthritis in his shoulder joint from his long-term instability. He had suffered a fracture of the front of the wing bone, which holds your shoulder in. And there's a meniscus in your shoulder joint called the labrum. And he had torn it in the front and in the back. So we took the fractured piece of bone off where he was missing his joint surface, transplanted this bone and two tendons right down here to the front of his shoulder. Now this piece of bone will then block the shoulder from coming out of joint. And the tendons will also, as you raise your arm, push the humeral head or your arm bone back into joint.
Tim spent the off-season rehabilitating with Flyers physical conditioning coach Pat Croce and looked forward to September and training camp. But by August, something was wrong. The surgical screw used in the operation had come loose, and a larger screw then had to be inserted. But still more complications followed.
Through a period of time, I had lost my appetite and started to lose weight rapidly, and I ended up losing 25 pounds to where I haven't weighed 205 or 204 since I was about 14 years old. So there was definitely something wrong, and finally they did some tests and found that I had an infection in my shoulder.
The infection had to be drained, and the timetable for Tim's return was again pushed back. Tim would undergo a total of 5 operations. His dream of playing in the Canada Cup Series against the Russians was shattered. He would also watch his team play 72 games in the 87-88 season without him. His frustration mounted as he saw his teammates get off to a dismal 6-13-3 start. It appeared that Murphy's Law had taken hold. The Flyers were missing his goal production desperately.
When you get into a bad rut, rather than get out of that rut, the rut gets deeper. To go into a rut, a lot of times you'll slide slowly and slowly, and then when you realize it, you're down there pretty deep and it's tough to get out of. And things go bad for you, and you start hitting posts, and the goalie's making unbelievable saves on you. Sometimes it'll work on your mind, and you get into that little rut. Shows a lot of respect for the Flyers organization not to go and start trading a lot of players. And Bob Clark and the Snyder family held our team together and kept the guys together, and they finally worked out of that slump.
In November, like a meteor, the Flyers shot out of last place in the Patrick Division. Now the Flyers were getting some breaks. The frustration was over. The Flyers had climbed out of a very deep hole, and by Christmas, found themselves in their customary position atop the Patrick Division.
The atmosphere and everything is so much better when you win. I think it's why the Flyers pride themselves on it and aren't out to break scoring records all the time. And, you know, and winning is where it's at.
By January, Tim had gained back much of the weight he had lost due to the infection. And now, he was believing the nightmare might be over.
I've always prided myself on working hard to getting in positions where you can be the best you can be. And going through what I did definitely knocked me down off a few walls. Trying to get back up is a lot tougher.
A man like that who's got his pride and works as hard as he works, to just have to sit there and watch the team struggle a number of times, or just to watch them, period, had to be probably very, very frustrating for him.
Head coach Mike Keenan had Tim watch home games from behind the bench.
Probably the biggest reason for Mike to put me behind there was to keep me in touch with the team. Throughout my rehabilitation, there was a lot of time periods where I didn't even see the team because I was going out to Broomall to work out with Pat, and the team would be on the road, and the only time I'd really see the guys and on the team and management and whatever would be at the games. If I watched every game like I was out there and I would have done this and that, I mean, I would have drove myself crazy with a lot of other people. You know, you have to put in your mind that it just wasn't going to be my time, and I put it out of my mind, and I worried about other things, like, for instance, getting my shoulder back in shape and, you know, getting steps further and further where I can get back and play. You like to think that, is it ever going to stop, and are you going to be able to get back out there and play? And you know, you have to roll the punches. I'm a pretty positive guy in terms of looking at positive things rather than negative things, and try to work back from that. And also had a lot of help from my friends and my wife, and, you know, that makes it a lot easier.
Daily News hockey writer Jay Greenberg knew how much the team missed Tim Kerr.
It was amazing to see the great variety of ways he had scored goals. I mean, he had the stereotype of it as the rebound comes and his hands are quicker than anybody else's and he reaches and puts them in. But he scored every kind of goal. I mean, he scored backhanded ones and he shot in wrist shots from 45 feet and he got a number of the goals that you remembered him scoring where a rebound comes out and his hands are quicker than anybody else's and he puts it by the goalie before the goalie can even move. It just reminded you just what a dynamic player he can be.
Inquirer hockey writer Al Morganti agreed.
Well, he's got the perfect temperament for it. He's like a big golden retriever. He's a happy guy and he's so big and guys beat on him. And he's got such a good attitude about it. He doesn't let it upset him mentally. He keeps himself focused in the game. He's so big. He's got a wingspan, actually, with the length of his arms and shoulders. And he's just such a powerful force. He takes root there and he's impossible to move out. Definitely an all-star. In this decade, one of the great right wings, a natural scoring talent, not a garbage man. He can score goals from 20, 25 feet and further.
Anywhere over the offensive team's blue line, he's dangerous. He's a guy who two people have to watch to be able to control him. And when that happens, it opens it up for other people on the ice.
So I think it's like a natural thing. My hands have always been fast, per se, while shooting the puck. It's probably one of my biggest assets that I have towards the game in scoring goals. And when I do get the puck, I shoot it right away and don't waste time. Therefore, the goalies aren't always set. It's just always something that I've had growing up. You know, I also work on it every day at practice when I'm out there and to try to sustain that.
This is a man that they took away 50 to 60 goals. And the way penalties were called in the NHL last season, who's to say he couldn't have scored 60 to 65 goals with the additional power play time they would have had? I think it would have been a far different season with Tim Kerr. Teams wouldn't have been able to fence the Flyers the way they did.
As the season progressed, the Flyers indeed needed a hero.
Where have all the good men gone?
The lightning in Tim Kerr's hands was returning. While he worked to build his strength, the team stayed together and prepared for another road trip.
Our trips in our division, our bus trips to New York and Washington and Jersey and Long Island, we have a good time on that bus. You know, a lot of card playing going on there, and I don't know if I'd ever want to play cards with these guys in a bar, because I don't know what kind of signs they got. The guys have a good time and they stay loose while they're away, and there's a lot of camaraderie between the players. You know, a lot of times we'll go and have team dinners together, and you know, everybody has their own little thing. It's more of a relaxed atmosphere. Because the team gets along so well, there's not really any problems, and you know, it's a good time.
You start screaming at the guy. I don't know what he's doing.
Nice.
Part 56.
Yeah.
If we do get a stay over and have to wait in an airport, some of the guys have a few fun times putting dollar bills and 20s on a string and laying them out in the middle. When people go to pick them up, they pull them away and stuff. But, you know, you have to be on your guard all the time. There's a lot of players that will pull some stuff on you if you're not watching real close. Well, if you got a weak ego, you don't want to get on that bus.
All of a sudden, you're working on your image, aren't you?
And Ron Sutter, blood and guts of the team right there.
On the golf course. That's where we should be doing this stuff, on the golf course.
Like Tom Weiskopf. Second all the time.
Yeah, second. My partner's gone, though. I picked up a new partner recently, Scott Mellenby. I had Lindsey Carson before, but he's been
Scott has real nice
moved out of the area. Now I have Scott.
Muzzy, it's okay to finish second, but you got to quit playing it at Twosome.
Oh, listen to you. Haven't played in 2 years.
It's okay.
Back
saving
there.
It. Saving it.
Saving it.
Too busy going to charity banquet.
Flyers traveling secretary Joe Cadleck arranged for another night in another hotel.
Talk with you. This was last night.
Flyers 4, Winnipeg 3. Martel, unbelievable.
Rick talking first time.
Yeah. You got 5-2 over Blues over Nordiques. 5-5. Leafs and Wings.
Hi, Brian. Have a seat, buddy. That's funny. All right, Nikki, where are the tea bags?
Within the players of the team, there's always been respect for other players in terms of standing behind them when they're on the ice in certain situations. Because of the way the Flyers play and their style, it has to be that way. There is always that professional respect to where if a player is in trouble, I mean, somebody has to be there. And I think that's always been, it's a Flyers tradition. The players that I've talked to from other teams that have moved around say they don't have that, and I think that is the biggest difference here in Philadelphia. Before we go out and in the dressing room, it's sort of a blocked out thing. You know, you're always going to get booed, and really it's a compliment. You know, the more they boo you, the more that they want to come and watch it. We've always gone out and played hard hockey in an aggressive style, and I think the media just brings that over. And there's just that black cloud riding over the Flyers' name. I don't think it'll ever go away. And we're obviously not a team that goes out and tries to start things. But, you know, we try to go out and start our game and play our type of style game, which a lot of times infuriates people. Teams that can't hold their composure on the road and can't take a check and aren't disciplined, are the teams that are going to get beat badly on the road. And the Flyers have always been a good road team for the reason that they are disciplined and they'll take their hits and they'll also give them out at the same time. In our own Patrick division, every team is geared up to play us. I mean, we've been the top team over the last 3 years, but when you're at the top, people always want to bring you down. You know, the Jersey Devils are an upcoming team. Washington's always going to be tough. The Islanders, they always have that respect that they're going to be there. And, you know, the Rangers, who knows where they can be? You don't know if they're going to be up or down. Pittsburgh, it's got Mary Lemieux and Paul Coffey, and they're a young team growing. They're going to be a tough team, and it's going to be a battle every time.
The team moved on to another city without their top scorer. Tim Kerr had now turned the corner.
Well, definitely there's been a lot of things that haven't gone my way over the last little while, and maybe been kicked off the rocks a few times, but I'm still standing. You can never know what it's like. Your blood like winter freezes just like ice. And there's a cold and lonely light that shines upon you. You wind up like the wreck you hide behind that mask you use. And did you think the smoke will never win? Well, look at me, I'm coming back again. I got a taste of love in a simple way. And if you need to know while I'm still standing, you just fade away. Don't you know I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life.
With Tim Kerr still battling back, fans flock to see another hero. Rick Tocchet may be the most beloved bad boy since Butch Cassidy tried to pick up the slack left by Kerr's absence.
Rick Tocchet is a very big part of this hockey team. He just came off a great series in the Canada Cup and I think proved a lot to himself and what type of player he can be. He's a catalyst on this team and he's a player that comes to play every night and he wants to take the responsibility of being a good hockey player, quote, star. He's a hard worker and he's definitely going to be there.
At one point, he caught fire and pumped in 14 goals in 6 games.
Out of that corner, checked nicely by Hammond in front. Tocchet shot, score! Samuelson is shot, misses. Tocchet in, shoot, score! A hat trick. Tocchet on a breakaway. He's got a chance for his third hat trick in the week. He's in, shot, score! Can you believe it? Don't touch it, fans. He's burning hot.
If Rick Tocchet is the will, then Ron Hextall is the way.
A lot of times the Flyers go as Ron Hextall go, and he obviously, you know, takes us a long way when he's playing well.
He played well enough one night in December to make NHL history.
Come back, flip it from their side of center in on Hextall. He blocks, looks to shoot it to the open net. He has scored! Ron Hextall has become the first player in the history of the National Hockey League, the first goaltender to actually score a goal.
In early February, word had leaked out that March 10th was considered a possible target date for Tim Kerr to return to action. Tim had not faced an NHL opponent in almost a year. The pressure mounted as word spread that the big man would be on the ice that night against Washington.
I don't know if I've ever heard a building where the crowd's been louder, and it's a great place to play, and the people are, I think, the best hockey fans in the world.
Number 12, Tim Kerr.
The one thing that I learned this year more than anything else that I haven't appreciated in a long time is how much I missed the game. It was good to get back, but it was a lot of frustration built up and a lot of hard work put into getting in a position to go out there and try it. I was nervous. You know, when you get to a certain level in the game, you don't want to be able to swallow that you can't get back to that level. Being in the crease and in front of the net, there's always a lot of action going on. It's like a challenge, it's like an inner game for me to go out there and stand in front of the net and try to be moved. It's been successful for me, and I've learned to make a living off of it. I know I had a chance to score in my first shift. You don't think, it's more your body takes control and you don't have time to think about, I guess I'm back. I just sort of got into the flow of the game and I tried to make the adjustment and then get back out there and then help the team.
Over 17,000 fans saw him try, but after two more games, his shoulder was exhausted and he was temporarily forced to the sidelines again.
No matter how hard you work in physical therapy and you try to simulate hitting a puck and everything, you can't really simulate what happens in a game. And Tim came back, and people knew he was a big scorer, and it's the playoffs. And now you're trying to hit a puck with other 200-pound guys hanging on you, pulling on your shoulder, knocking you over. You're trying to get your balance and everything. And so under game conditions, he still had to work hard in his shoulder. We got it to the point it was safe for him to play, but then we played him, and it was obvious that it still wasn't good enough to play full-time, highly competitive playoff hockey.
My ego made me go back and wanted me to go back, and my body wasn't really ready, and it told me that an awful lot, but it was just a matter of doing it anyway.
You could see the frustration in Timmy, and the doubt, I'm sure, that a number of times he must have wondered if he was ever going to play again. But I don't ever recall Pat Croce calling and saying that Tim didn't make a workout or that Tim wasn't working hard to come back. And for myself and people in our organization to see someone work that hard and to see the results of that work, him coming back to play, it was very gratifying to us.
The highlight of his comeback was his 14th career hat trick. It came in late March. Extraordinary, considering his near one-year layoff. Tim Kerr, still not fully healed, played sparingly in the playoffs as the Flyers and the Capitals staged a dramatic opening round series.
The Caps try to come out, caught by Poulin. Into the slot to talk, inside of the net.
Washington ultimately prevailed in overtime in Game 7, leaving Kerr frustrated and disappointed. It also left him more determined than ever. Tim Kerr's fight to come back is born from his great pride and perseverance, and from his father.
I was never a great player as a youngster growing up or even in junior hockey, and my dad was always there for me, and I can remember the days when I was a kid and he used to wake up and drive me to the rink at 4 in the morning when it was the only ice time available, and then come back and get me at 6 in the morning and then go to work at 8 sort of thing. And, there was never a question of, no, I can't take you tonight sort of thing. And, he's always been there for me. He's enjoyed the game and has never pushed me, and, I gave a lot of it to him.
Tim Kerr is running towards his dream of a Stanley Cup with the power to shape his own destiny. He now aims at leading his team back to glory. His is the story of a hero fighting back.